can listen again to any shows at bcfmradio.com and leave comments about your favourite programmes. BCFM 93.2, your interactive station, 24 hours a day.
The goal of the Bilderberg Group is a one-world totalitarian government and economic system. Is the common man really as stupid as the elite seem to believe?
Welcome back to BCFM's Politics Show with old Labour Oxford economist Martin Summers and me, Tony Gosling. War's old and new, from today's D-Day commemoration in Normandy to the battlefields of eastern Ukraine. Well, a new campaign has just been launched this week against the British government and the European Union's support for fascists in Ukraine's new Kiev government. Yes, despite the newly elected president saying he doesn't want violence, the Ukrainian army, air force and paramilitaries are still mounting deadly attacks in the east of the country against their own people. They, in turn, have held what they say are legal, but others say are illegal, referenda, saying they want nothing to do with the new regime, which they say came into power in a NATO, US and EU-backed coup. Well, also, the 70th anniversary of D-Day is all over the media today, but was Operation Overlord, the Normandy landings, really the turning point in the war, as so many commentators are saying? Or did that come 2.5 years previous to that, in early 1942, over in Stalingrad, when the Russians began to turn around the German advance? We look 3 months ahead of D-Day to September 1944, and Operation Market Garden begin to look at some of the events around it, as deals were done between Britain, the US and the Nazis for their precious technology, which included uranium and possibly plutonium too for the Manhattan Project. Plus, Martin Summers takes us on a tour of some of the world's hotspots too. But we start this week with Jay Blackwood, who's joining us here in the studio. He's from this new campaign, Bristol's Ukraine Anti-Fascist Solidarity Campaign. Hi, Jay, and welcome to the Politics Show.
Hello there, thank you.
Tell us a little bit about yourself, Jay.
I'm sort of semi-retired at the moment. I've been living in Bristol for about 10 years. My partner was Ukrainian, and through her, she died a few years back, but through her, obviously, I met other Ukrainians and Russians, particularly when I was living in London, and I've been out to Ukraine myself.
OK, tell us a little bit about the country for people who've never visited it. Obviously, we've got Marina, who works on this show. She's actually over in the Ukraine at the moment, and she has been quite critical of the Russians in all of this. But just give us your own personal view of what about the country when you sort of land and you get out of the plane or you drive over there or whatever. What's different about Ukraine to here in Bristol and Britain?
I think there are the most obvious thing is that there's a very rich history and a very conflicted history in Ukraine. So you see that in simple things like the architecture, where you have kind of beautifully designed buildings from the 18th century next to Soviet-era concrete monstrosities. You see that in Odessa itself, which is a very beautiful city. And that kind of reflects the troubled history that the country has had. And to some extent, it reflects the really big ethnic and cultural divides in Ukraine as well.
Okay, so what is the Bristol Ukraine Anti-Fascist Solidarity Campaign? What is it all about?
Well, we're hoping to cut through really what's been a wall of propaganda in the Western media, and that propaganda has principally been aimed at portraying the overthrow of the previous elected government in Ukraine as a sort of popular revolution that was fought in the name of democracy, in the name of being European, and that was fought as a kind of anti-imperialist struggle against the Russians.
Well, hang on, because it was, surely. I mean, I saw back in November last year, even, there were people coming to the main square, Maidan Square in Kiev, all sorts of people, different shapes and colours from all over the country, saying, look, we've just had enough of this government.
Absolutely. It was a corrupt government, as the present one is as well already, because what you have in Ukraine and what you've had since the fall of the old Soviet bloc, which I'm certainly not here to defend, but what you've had is a government of oligarchs, one government after another. Some of them play to the people in the east, some of them play primarily to the people in the west. They're corrupt governments. But what you saw in the Maidan protests was when those protests actually moved to seize state power, it wasn't the ordinary protesters that were there from the start, the people in colourful costumes that overthrew the government. It was the paramilitaries of Pravy Sektor and Svoboda, which are the fascist parties in Ukraine.
OK, tell us about those two parties.
OK, Svoboda is, in a way, the most worrying. Pravy Sektor is an out-and-out open fascist party, and Svoboda is a party that's, in a sense, done a BNP, in that it's fronted by men in suits. They now hold a third of the posts in the current government, even after the recent election. Those posts include the Interior Ministry, National Security, Defence, the Defence Council, setting up a National Guard. They originated as the National Socialist Party of Ukraine. Their symbol was the wolf's angle, which is a Nazi insignia. And then a few years back, under advice from other organisations, including groups in the West, they were really advised to put up a more democratic front. But even very recently, the European Parliament, which obviously has backed the Maidan movement, criticised them as a neo-fascist anti-Semitic organisation and advised people to have nothing to do with them. So even the EU, a couple of years ago, saw through the facade to the Nazis underneath it.
Old Labour Oxford economist Martin Summers, can I just bring you in here? Because obviously this is a bit worrying when you've got these kinds of fascist parties in such key positions, as Jay was just listing there, in the present government.
Yes, and if you go back to February the 22nd, when the coup took place, there was a discussion in the morning between
Yanukovych
and the EU negotiators and the leaders of the opposition parties, and an agreement was made for early elections, government of national unity, for the protesters to calm down, and a deal was being done. As that deal was being put in place, the only person not in the room discussing what should happen was a representative of the United States of America. They were excluded from the discussion. But as they left the meeting, snipers started shooting both police officers, Bearcut riot police, and protesters. And ultimately, a taped phone call between Catherine Ashton and Umas Piets, the head of the Estonian Foreign Ministry, he had gone round the hospitals, and he was hearing from the doctors that all of the people killed had been killed by the same set of snipers using the same bullets, all mostly coming from Hotel Ukraina, which was under the control of Pravy Sektor and Pravy Sektor's leader, Andriy Parubiy. Now, in other words, they came to power by shooting those protesters that you mentioned earlier, the ones in the colourful costumes, the people who just wanted to join the EU and all the rest of it. Now, this fits a pattern. It's these people are fascists, that's for sure, but they've had linkages with NATO's intelligence services going back.
But why would Pravy Sektor shoot their own supporters?
They're not shooting their own supporters. In any case, it's not entirely clear that Pravy Sektor, these snipers were professionals. It's quite possible that it wasn't, in fact, just random fascists who were doing the shooting. The point is that these groups have linkages with NATO's intelligence services going back a long way. And people who are frequently listen to this programme will know that we constantly talk about Gladio. Gladio was set up as a secret structure within NATO, carrying out terrorist attacks in Western Europe through the 70s and 80s, including the bombing of Bologna railway station, probably the biggest one that they carried out, killed 80-odd people. It's quite clear from investigations by the Italian police force that this was carried out by NATO, and that means CIA MI6. I see CIA MI6 fingerprints all over this, and of course I'm quite sure that the Russian secret services see it exactly that way. They are behaving very calmly in the face of what is extreme provocation. And then we've got even more provocation in Odessa, which I'm sure that Jay knows that again was another organised provocation. And the key person in both provocations is this guy, Parubiy. Now, he, in fact, is the quarterback. We need to sack him, We need to be asking questions of our representatives here and in Europe, saying, what are we doing about Andriy Parubiy? He's the guy that killed all the people in the Maidan, and he's the guy that killed all the people in Odessa. And, of course, he's probably working with MI6 and CIA.
OK, but before we hear from Jay Blackwood on what happened in Odessa, what's your thoughts about what happened back in February? I think it was the 23rd, wasn't it, Martin? I think it was a Friday, as I remember, while this show was going out, there was all these sniper shootings going on. And at the end of the negotiations with Yanukovych, there was a load of military people basically stormed their parliament. So what's your view about what happened that day and how relevant that is?
I think that there are obviously different takes on who was behind it exactly and on what went on the day. There are different, as with everything with Ukraine at the moment, there are what you might call different narratives, and they're backed up by different people. I find Martin's view of this very interesting, and it's something that I would want to look into further. What my understanding is, I mean, the shooting took place and then the parliament building was stormed and the government was overthrown. Now, whoever carried the shooting out, and however corrupt the existing government was, it was an elected government. It was important because in a country that's riven by cultural differences, to actually completely destroy any pretense of a democratic change of government in favour of storming the parliament building on behalf of, if you like, one cultural ethnic group. Using the word ethnic is dangerous in this situation, but let's say one cultural or national group. As soon as that happened, everything changed. And from that moment on, what we're beginning to see now, which is a kind of descent into an awful civil war, was almost inevitable.
OK, what about Odessa? What happened there?
Well, in Odessa, and I know Martin's spoken quite a lot about this, I think, as well, what we certainly had, sifting through the conflicting accounts, is a situation where you had a protest camp outside the trade union building in Odessa. And that protest camp was basically a protest against the putsch in Kiev, a protest against the new government and the fascist elements within it, and an expression as well of anxiety amongst Russian speakers in Ukraine about the direction the country was going in. That was attacked. There doesn't seem to be any dispute about that. There was then an assault on the building itself where the protesters took refuge. And we know that 42 people were killed, maybe a lot more, and obviously a lot more were injured. At the very least, they were firebombed to death. There's a lot of evidence that it went deeper than that, that people were murdered inside the building, that Pravy Sektor, one of the two fascist groups particularly, were involved in organising that, and that the police in Odessa collaborated in order to basically muddy the water in terms of responsibility. And there was a big furore about that after the event throughout Europe, actually, and in Ukraine itself.
Well, I know it's been very important for you as an individual to go into this in your own way, to look into and research what actually happened, because, you know, you're saying, as and I would agree with you, that there are particularly slanted propagandistic views coming at this from the Western media. But it's another step, isn't it, to actually moving towards setting up actually a campaign. So why did you set the campaign up?
Basically, this has been set up by myself and two or three other individuals. That's how it started. And now, fortunately, there are other Bristolians, and I was talking to a Ukrainian woman in Bristol earlier on today who's going to be involved. It's building up. But we established it because what we believe is happening in Ukraine at the moment is something that could develop in the direction of what we saw in Spain in 1936. For the first time in Europe itself, and we can see echoes of this in countries like Greece with the Golden Dawn movement, but for the first time in Europe itself since the Second World War, we're actually seeing fascists in government, backed by Western capital, backed by the United States particularly, given logistical advice by the United States. And what we're seeing in the East is the direct result of that, which is a war by the Kiev government against its own people, using heavy artillery, tanks, attack helicopters, aeroplanes, and so on. If you have fascists in government, that's what you get. And we want, in our own way, to build solidarity with the people fighting that. There's also a national campaign, which was launched last week. And we're also going to link up with that. So we're hoping this will build into a national movement to raise awareness, really, as well as solidarity.
Well, some will say you're being a bit paranoid, that actually the far right over there is really maybe more like the BNP or something like that here, which is not such a large movement, certainly doesn't have access to the sort of private armies that you're suggesting, and also that there is a legitimate concern that the breakaway groups in the east of Ukraine are actually just simply breaking the law now, that there's been a presidential election, and the idea that they can just sort of separate from Ukraine and become another country. Well, I mean, surely people can't simply do that. I mean, here in Bristol, maybe we would like to, but we can't just stick two fingers up at Westminster and say, sorry, guys, we're having nothing to do with you anymore.
I think there's... I mean, the difference is that when that recent election was held, East Ukraine was already under military attack, heavy military attack, on the day of the election from its own unelected government in Kiev, the government which has this big fascist presence. And in those circumstances, nobody apart from the Western media, who've played an extraordinary role, could really say those would count as free and fair elections. It's okay, let's imagine somebody in Bristol decided, yes, we're going to have a West Country Republic. We don't like what London's doing. We never have. We're going to have a republic. Let's have a vote on it. But first, let's put up with being bombed, shelled, shot down in the streets, and let's see how the vote goes and abide by the result. You know, we wouldn't really see that as democracy in any form that we recognise. For fascists, it's a very familiar form of democracy. It's the democracy of the bullet.
What about Spain, 1936? You mentioned that. What happened there, and why do you draw this comparison with today?
The comparison is that in Spain you had a situation where fascism was, I mean, eventually did come to power, and you had a civil war that was fought to defeat the forces of fascism. At the time, similarly to what we have in Ukraine now, the forces of fascism were colluded with by American capital and by West European capital. We're seeing the same thing now. We're seeing the same attempts to confuse the issue, to muddy the waters. And amongst some, there's a growing feeling in the labour movement, the trade union movement, we're beginning to see a shift where people recognise that just as in Spain in 36, there was a need for solidarity to fight fascism, we need that now as well, because fascism plus finance capital plus American Western intelligence and power really needs more than just the citizen militias in the east of Ukraine to fight it successfully.
Well, George Orwell and others went over to help, didn't they, in the Spanish Civil War to fight against Franco. Are you saying that people should maybe do the same in Ukraine?
I think I'd be reluctant to actually say that on the radio regardless. I don't want Inspector Naka knocking on my door later on tonight. I think what people do in terms of solidarity at the moment is more to do with raising awareness, and I don't mean that in a wishy-washy way. I mean bringing it up in their trade unions, bringing it up in their political organisations, and starting to tackle the media, which is why it's really good that we can even have this discussion on here today, because this is not a discussion we're really hearing anywhere else. So I think solidarity is practical and direct in that way. I'm not necessarily suggesting to people they should go over there and pick up a Kalashnikov.
Martin, do you think Jay's correct in drawing comparisons with Spain in 1936?
Yes, and the other comparison I draw is with Yugoslavia, where I used to work in the 90s. Mm. And of course, when Slovenia declared independence of Yugoslavia, the West... And they opened fire on the Yugoslav National Army, the Slovenian National Guard. The West cheered them on. And this is where the Russians say, well, hang on a minute, when Slovenia breaks away, when Croatia breaks away, when Kosovo breaks away, you cheer them on. And in actual fact, when the Slovenians didn't have to shoot the National Guard, the Yugoslav National Army, but they knew that if they did, it would precipitate. I mean, I don't think there's any evidence that the militias in the East started the fighting with the Ukrainian army. The Ukrainian army came to fight with them.
Absolutely.
And the other thing I point out is that underlying all of this is the economic policy in Ukraine. I wrote a book about economic policy in Eastern Europe with Laszlo Andor, who's now a European commissioner. He's a Hungarian guy. And in that book, published in 1998, we said if they try to enforce IMF structural adjustment in Ukraine, just like in Yugoslavia, the state will disintegrate. Don't forget, Crimea was only tacked onto Ukraine in 1952. Mm. The whole country has only been an independent state since the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991. It never existed as a state in that before that. And in the very word Ukraine simply means borderland in the Slavic language.
Well, it's pretty big. It's the enormous borderland country in Europe.
And that's why the Second World War, when we come to the Second World War, the Second World War was decided in Ukraine. I mean, the sadness of the history of the region is palpable. I used to live in Poland, and used to carry out any kinds of building work, and you people find mass graves, and this is all living memory. Mm. Same in Yugoslavia.
Anyway, Jay, what's happening in Ukraine today then?
Well, today, literally, we've seen a stepping up of the attacks. I mean, what's interesting is, you know, we've had the election of this guy, Poroshenko, who's another oligarch. He's the chocolate king of Ukraine, which makes him sound really nice and kind of cuddly. And the first thing he did when he came to power was to talk about ending the civil war. But since then, it's clear that his way of ending the civil war is to end it with a military victory. Today, we've seen tanks attacking the town of Slavyansk, which is in the Donetsk region in the east. And what we're beginning to see off and on is an intensification of the fighting. And amongst those troops that are attacking the civilian centres in the east, we have this National Guard that was set up by Andriy Parubiy, who is the founder of Svoboda, the fascist party. They're fighting alongside the troops, partly because we've seen troops defect and refuse to fire on their own people. Having a neo-Nazi standing next to you with a revolver is a good way of ensuring that you actually carry out orders, and that's what's happening. So today we've seen that. We've also seen, bizarrely, Putin, who's been put forward as the new great Satan for the West, talking to Poroshenko about compromise. Mm-hmm. The idea that East Ukraine is all about Russian influence and wanting to be annexed to Russia is palpably not true. Russia is very wary indeed about direct involvement in eastern Ukraine.
And is that simply because that could draw them into a conflict with NATO? We've already heard that NATO are going to be carrying out exercises in Ukraine.
Absolutely. And the opposition to those NATO exercises, that's something that our campaign will be supporting and has been supporting. No, Russia is very nervous for two other reasons, not just because of how the West will react. It's very nervous because, frankly, East Ukraine, although it's an industrial heartland, is a run-down and decaying industrial heartland. There's a lot
of... Sounds like the north of England.
There's a lot of similarities. It's old industry. On steroids, yeah. There's a lot of old industry. The other thing is, in Russia you have, and have had for a long time, the rule of the oligarchs. As opposed to what you hear on the BBC and so on, it is a democratic country, although it's a faltering democratic country. But, you know, Putin's elected and re-elected because he's popular. But what the oligarchs in Russia don't want is an armed militant population to suddenly come into the Russian Federation, because that would destabilise it. And that's really not in the interests of the Russian ruling class.
Now, the comparisons with former Yugoslavia, Martin, and Spain, what does that tell us about what might happen in Ukraine?
Well, I think Putin, by saying that he's going to talk to Poroshenko, I mean, Putin came to power, he disciplined the oligarchy, sent Khodorkovsky to prison and so on, but, you know, he's also a representative of the oligarchy. But I think he's actually a very skillful politician. I wouldn't vote for him. I'd probably vote communist if I lived in Russia. But, I mean, he's a very skillful politician. And what he's saying to Poroshenko is, look, you've got some kind of a mandate. So have the people in the East Ukraine. Why don't we just sit down and sort this out? Call your dogs off and let's come to some arrangement about this. And that's perfectly straightforward and logical. And that's the sort of thing that we were trying to get people to do in Bosnia back in the 90s. Look, stop shooting everybody. Everybody stop shooting and let's have a chat.
But fascists don't always respond
very well
when you say let's sit down and come to some arrangement.
No, but underlying all of this is NATO's strategy. LEAP 2020, the French think tank that I often look at their stuff, they pointed out straight away what this is all about is the trade partnership deal with the US, the TIIP. I can't remember
TTIP, Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership.
That's the one I'm talking about. And of course, Perfectly normally, relations within the European Union and the Russian Federation, the economic ties are thickening and strengthening. And ultimately, what this does is it draws an iron curtain across Europe. Don't do deals with the Russians, do deals with us, i.e. America. Mm. And the German ruling class are being put on the spot here, because they would quite happily do very good, they're already doing very, very lucrative deals with the Germans. You've got three former German chancellors who are criticising Merkel's position on all of this. And, of course, what's happening is that the European Union is being stampeded in a certain direction. So NATO strategists have got what they want out of this, which is just to create tension between Russia and the EU, and therefore, you know, divide and rule. Strangely enough, Marine Le Pen from the French National Front made exactly that point. This is an American war to make trouble for Europe. That's
so
what she's
why?
Saying.
I mean, we've also heard Nigel Farage actually questioning the EU's policy there. So this is bizarre. We've got the right wing, or you might say far right, not or extreme right, or anyway, whatever UKIP are saying, what the EU's doing is wrong here. They're sort of it doesn't seem to make sense. You would expect that they would maybe be supporting other far right people. But they're not. They're saying completely the opposite.
Yes, but what Nigel Farage has got wrong about this is it isn't the EU that's doing this, it's NATO and the Americans. I mean, was it famously Victoria Nuland said, F the EU, and that's the whole point of all of this, is to make the EU dysfunctional and undermine the relations with the Russians.
And in the meantime, we've heard this week that President Obama has announced a plan. This is the day before the D-Day celebrations, commemorations, to invest $1 billion in stepping up its military presence in Eastern Europe amid the Ukrainian crisis. White House will send more troops and equipment to the region and reaffirm its commitment to its NATO allies. He was speaking at a news conference in Warsaw. Obama said America was stepping up its partnership with the countries in Eastern Europe with a view to bolstering security. Moves are aimed at upping the pressure on Russia, which Washington is accused of inciting unrest in Ukraine, Jay.
Yes, I mean, I think the strategy that the US is following, that NATO is following, the long-term strategy is pretty obviously to completely encircle and isolate Russia. And I think it's part of the kind of broader approach, which is, you know, you had that strategy put forward years ago, the new American century, where the idea is that the US will dominate in all arenas and in all geographical areas. And part of that is to cut off and encircle Russia. And we saw that with the attempt. I mean, part of what was going on in Ukraine was really, I suppose, the dream on the part of the US State Department that Russia would lose Crimea and the base of its Black Sea fleet. So I think there's a grand game being played by the Americans. It's extremely a very, very dangerous game, not least for Europeans, East and West. And I think one of the interesting things is, if you talk to Ukrainians and Russians and people from that region, and I'm sure Martin would have probably seen this in the former Yugoslavia, the view from the East, looking West, is very different from the view that we're given in this country. They see a growing power, a growing aggression, and a growing encirclement. And we really need to be more aware of that if we want to engage in international politics and diplomacy, as opposed to simply fight an endless series of proxy wars across the world.
Can I just say about Warsaw, the Polish magazine Nie, which is basically their private eye, they were reporting that Parubiy's people were trained at a police academy outside Warsaw before they were sent back to take over in Kiev. So in other words, I think the evidence is piling up that these provocations were not carried out by the fascists and the West's turning a blind eye. They are working closely with them. And, of course, Catherine Ashton, it's quite clear from the intercepted telephone call, is not in the loop. She's going, gosh, really? That's shocking. So what you've got is the EU being used as a condom by NATO. And this is where Nigel Farage didn't get it right. It's not the EU that's making the problems here. It's NATO, which is underpinning the EU, of course. And, of course, NATO has been carrying out bomb attacks and assassinations in Western Europe for decades now. There's a book came out 18 months ago now by Fernando Imposimato, who's the head of the Italian Supreme Court. It's called La Repubblica dei Strani Impuni, The Republic of the Unpunished Massacres, and it's quite clear that from the bombing in Piazza Fontana in 1969 right through, and there was a similar things happening in the Brabant massacres in Belgium, the Dortmund Beer Hall massacre in Germany, NATO intelligence services are out of control. They've been out of control for a long long time, and it's not something that they've just got out of control. The evidence is there. There have been three parliamentary inquiries in Switzerland, in Italy and in Belgium. The European Parliament has passed a resolution about all of this. The fact of the matter is that CIA and MI6 are terrorists, and the Russian Secret Service know that very well. They're terrorists as well, that's why they know.
OK, Martin, I'm going to come back to a question I asked you before, which you sort of stepped round or maybe got slightly diverted, which is the experience of former Yugoslavia and Spain, 1936. What does that tell us that might happen in Ukraine as a projected future?
What would be nice to happen is if Poroshenko shows some independence from his Western masters and leads Ukraine in the obvious direction for it to go, which is to be friends with everybody. There's no reason. I mean, that's basically what Yushchenko in the end wouldn't sign up for the deal because it was too much against Ukraine's interest. If you're going to have an IMF structural adjustment policy, you're saying to everybody in the East Ukraine, the Rust Belt, we're going to put you all out of work. We're not going to put you on the dole because there isn't any dole. We're just going to put you out of work. Yep. That's what we're going to do with you. Now, that, of course, there's not been a structural adjustment in Ukraine as there was in Russia in the 90s, the Gaidar plan and so on, because everybody realised that it was a Yugoslavia waiting to happen. What caused the Yugoslavian war was IMF structural adjustment policies, forcing the country to make decisions that they didn't want to make. When the pie is shrinking, somebody's got to lose some pie, haven't they? So who's going to lose pie? More pie? Is it going to be Slovenia? Is it going to be Serbia? And the same thing happens in Ukraine. If we're going to shrink the pie, and of course the Ukrainian economy now is in freefall, that's what's going as a result of all this.
Okay, Jay, what are your concerns about the future? If things don't go well in Ukraine?
I mean, my main concern, and this comes partly from, I think to some extent, the people that smelt a rat with this stuff quite early on were people that maybe had some prior experience of Eastern Europe in some form, you know. And the worry is, and this came up very early on, what we'll see in Ukraine will be ethnic cleansing, and ethnic cleansing on a scale that will make the Balkan War, the breakup of Yugoslavia, look like a picnic. I mean, you now have a modern army with a fascist militia alongside it. It's an open question whether Poroshenko could move against the fascists in his government, even if he wanted to. He doesn't control the army, he doesn't control the Justice Department or the police. So what you could have is a situation where the armies of West Ukraine basically move to crush the cities in the east, and to do that effectively, they would have to carry out an absolute slaughter. That's the main worry. The possibility is of a sane federal solution to the question. And I'm afraid to say, I mean, from the moment where the Americans and the Europeans threw a match into the powder keg, that was always going to be the most favourable outcome. The idea that Ukraine would continue in its existing form once the whole thing was blown out of the water was always going to be unlikely. But the risks are, at worst, not only that you have ethnic cleansing, but that you have a neo-fascist government holding absolute power in the centre of Europe.
And also, we've got these next month NATO exercises scheduled, not actually in Ukraine, but around Ukraine. We've just heard also that Britain is offering tanks and 1,000 troops for this NATO show of strength against Putin. British Armoured Battle Group could join the NATO manoeuvres in Poland as the alliance reinforces exercises in response to the Ukraine crisis. That's in the Daily Telegraph, Britain offering NATO an armoured battle group, including 25 tanks, to join exercises in Poland. So this is next month. This does seem a little bit unnecessary at the moment because the Kiev government doesn't seem to be threatened by military force from the east of Ukraine, and neither from Russia.
No, absolutely. I think, I mean, my understanding is the exercises will actually be in Ukraine itself as well, but we may have different, I mean, things are changing day by day, but certainly the Stop the War Coalition, which is the national, you know, sort of anti-war group that was formed over Iraq, they are saying that those exercises will actually take place on Ukrainian soil. So if that happens in the midst of what is developing into a civil war, you could be looking at World War III. I mean, if I can say, part of the reason that Russia may eventually intervene against its own ruling class's interests is pressure from below in Russia, pressure from people in Russia. If you see ethnic cleansing on a large scale in the east, the majority in Russia will not stand by and let that happen. That's something else that we need to be aware of. It's not just down to Putin and what Putin wants. It's also down to the amount of of popular pressure from below over this issue.
Martin, I'm just looking at the mainstream press articles on these exercises. It does look as if they are around Ukraine, not in Ukraine. But what are your thoughts about the wisdom or otherwise of that?
Well, it's just pouring more fuel on the fire, isn't it? What they need to do, and what they should be doing at this D-Day commemoration and all the rest of it, is get banging a few heads together. And Putin, basically, is offering himself, saying, I will be a mediator for you with these East Ukrainian people. I'm going to talk to this Poroshenko chap. And what he actually said, Poroshenko doesn't have blood on his hands, which is actually not true, because Poroshenko, it seems to me, said that he was going to fix the East Ukraine in a matter of days or hours, and that's crazy. I mean, somebody, I don't know who said earlier that they're a modern Ukraine. The Ukrainian army isn't modern. That's why they've got all these kind of paramilitary groups attached to them. Mm. At the moment, we've got what is basically irregular warfare. It seems that the Donetsk and Luhansk militias have got access to ground-to-air equipment. And that's going to be a game-changer, because they shot down a helicopter with the commander of the Ukrainian National Guard in it and various other people. Mm, yeah. If the rebels in Syria had ground-to-air facilities, they might have done rather better than they have, although, of course, this is all tied in with what's happened in Syria, where it looks as if Bashar Assad has got more of a mandate, for example, than Sisi managed to get in Egypt the week before.
OK, well, so we've heard also today that at the D-Day celebrations, the new president of Ukraine, Poroshenko, has met Putin in the diplomacy behind D-Day. There'll be some stuff about that on Channel 4 News after this show. But as they met in France at a commemoration ceremony, they say, for the D-Day landing 70 years on, Russia's President Vladimir Putin and the Ukrainian president-elect Petro Poroshenko jointly called for an end to the bloodshed still taking place in Ukraine. In a brief conversation, both the men called for a speedy end to bloodshed in southeast Ukraine, as well as fighting on both sides by the Ukrainian armed forces, as well as by supporters of the federalisation of Ukraine. It's the first time the pair have met since Moscow annexed Crimea earlier this year, and comes as the fighting continues in the east of Ukraine around Donetsk and Slavyansk. Clashes between Ukraine's military and pro-Russian protesters, which Russia denies having any official links to despite Western accusations, have in fact intensified since the election of pro-Western businessman Petro Poroshenko. Jay Blackwood, I mean, this does sound like at least there's dialogue going on, but whether it's going to go anywhere?
It's a good question. I mean, there's the idea that Putin has control over the militias in East Ukraine, I think is actually, it's not an accurate reflection of what's going on. There may be some Russian fighters that have crossed the border into East Ukraine. I'd be surprised if there weren't. But basically what you have is militias raised in those cities. Ukraine is a country swimming with ex-Soviet era hardware. Mm-hmm. When I was in Ukraine on holiday, I was offered a gun. I said, oh, I don't really want to buy a gun. I'm here for a vacation. So I was offered a Kalashnikov. I mean, this is a country absolutely swimming with armaments. The idea that the fighters in the east are armed by the Russians is only an idea that holds water for people that don't really know much about Eastern Europe. Whether Putin and Poroshenko will be able to come to any meaningful agreement is different from the question of whether they can put out an anodyne statement saying we all want peace, now, because of course we all do.
Yeah, I know you've got a petition running, haven't you, about these forthcoming exercises?
Yeah, there's a petition. If people Google Stop the War Coalition, that will point to the petition calling on NATO and, well, for Britain to withdraw from those NATO exercises.
I'd like to hear what Nigel Farage has to say about that.
Okay, and that's Jay Blackwood, you were hearing there, who was one of the founders of the Bristol Ukraine Anti-Fascist Solidarity Campaign. You can find more about that on the internet at buafs.wordpress.com. So, Jay Blackwood, thanks very much for joining us on the Politics Show.